very interesting application of blockchain technology, such as the decentralized drop box. Please welcome Rand.
All right, thank you everyone. My name is Ryan Raymond. Still get that off?
Yeah, that's off.
Okay. Stay away from the speaker. My name is Ryan Raymond, selected the community president by Storj, by people just like you participating in our forums, and so that's all I'm here. It's Derek Irving, he's one of our finance and PR guys. We've got Andrew over here, he's our hardware integration person. So I'm here to tell you a little bit about Storj. The last two presenters have mentioned us a couple times, so I think the first thing to do is I'll just run a quick little video here.
Imagine if the cloud wasn't up here, but down here, with us. That's storage. Storage is a cloud shared by the community. It's potentially the largest, cheapest, and most secure cloud available. What you share is what you get. You can even be paid by renting your extra space. But how is it more secure? Each file is shredded, encrypted, and spread across the network until you're ready to use it again. And you can be sure the files are safe because the keys are in your pocket, not a company's. Only you have access to your stuff. Because the network is shared, you don't have to worry about slow download speeds coming from one place. We're all helping to make the system blazing fast. And if you have some extra space lying around, you'll get paid by users who need more than they can share. It's like renting out your empty hard drives. A cloud with security, no downtime, and speed at a fraction of the cost.
All right, so. Turn this volume down a little bit here. So storage. People may ask, how is this going to work and how does this tie into Bitcoin? Well, we're using the blockchain technology of itself here. We're not.
Is there another microphone in the computer?
I don't know.
The laptop.
You're loud enough to talk.
Yeah, I. Okay.
I'll just kill the microphone. I think everybody can hear me pretty well. So, getting back to what I was saying. With storage, we're expanding on Bitcoin, the technology behind Bitcoin. We've had a lot of people talking about Bitcoin as a currency, its value as a currency, how it can hold monetary value, how it can be used for transactions. But the technology behind that is the blockchain. The blockchain itself is a transaction engine. So we can prove, as fact, as Brian was saying with fact, we can prove who owns something. We can prove who did something because we come to a consensus with the blockchain. With what we can do with storage is I upload my wedding video to the network. That file is encrypted, taken up into chunks, each chunk is hashed, and then spread out in redundancy across the network. So your hard drive gets one of my chunks, your hard drive. Everyone's hard drive gets a little piece of my file. So in that sense, it's working like a BitTorrent network. Except with BitTorrent, to be a seeder, you have to want to share that file. So how do we incentivize people to share that file? As Brian mentioned, Counterparty has an ability to create tokens. We've created a token for the network that people will buy their space using this token. You'll be paid in that token, and you can go around and buy more space on the network. Now, a lot of people think of this as just a Dropbox type application. In a way, that's true. We do have MetaDisk, if you want to pull that up. So we have MetaDisk. This is our first application we built. And with this, we can drag and drop files into it. And put Ms. Zhang's presentation into it. So, okay. We have Ms. Zhang's presentation. Now I want to share that with someone. I can just copy the link that's got the key and the hash for the file. I can send it to my friend over here and say, hey, look at this presentation. It'll pull it from the network. Or I can keep it secure in my file libraries that I am the only person that has the key to those files. Nobody else can touch those files. The people storing your files only have a chunk of your data. If they modify your file, we will do periodic checks on the integrity of the files. So if they fail a challenge, they stop getting paid. It's incentivized to keep the file integrity intact. Do you want to expand that out? Maximize the screen again. So, and you can see, you can just simply download the file, copy the URL. Up at the top, there's a text box. If someone shares a hash and a key with you, you can add it to your library. So this is the first application that's been built on top of Storj. Using the APIs that we've created, some people have already used the ability to play a video that's stored on the network, share images, play music. So think of Pandora, YouTube, Imgur, any of those types of services could use Storj as a backend. Or someone like you, with a little bit of coding experience, could sit down, write an application, and use this as your backend. Keep in mind right now, Storj is in a development stage. We are currently working on finishing up DriveShare. If you want to pull this up, this is our dashboard that we've created here. We've got a few nodes running across the world. I can see Andrew's, I can see mine, Josh, Will, Nick over in London. With these here, we can see what our uptime is on each node. We're doing this as kind of preliminary testing to see how often something drops off the network. Because when a computer drops off the network and it's storing one of your files, we need to upload it to a new node. We need to identify that that is no longer available and make your files available somewhere else. And that's kind of the basic rundown of Storj here. Derek wants to talk a little bit about the intrinsic value of the coin that we have. Well, I shouldn't say coin. It's a token. It's a credit for the network that you'll buy space with.
So the first talk really talked about how Bitcoin by itself, fundamentally, if nobody trusted it, would be worthless, which is true with a lot of currencies, like she stated. But the interesting about Storj and a couple other products that are coming out is that people are starting to realize that we couldn't put an actual value behind these or backing it, much like the gold standard or any other commodity standard. And so what Storj has is that it has data storage itself behind it. So everything in this world, as everybody knows here, we all have smartphones, laptops, those all use data cloud storage somewhere in the world at one point. Storj takes advantage of this massive growing cloud network and then creates a token that's actually backed by it. Unlike Bitcoin, it has something you can't touch it and you can't like know what cloud storage is, but you can use it on an everyday basis and people know what it is on a layman terms, and it's easy to understand and it can give it value. So it's kind of interesting to see that Storj is one of the most growing ones and it has a value behind it, which is interesting, unlike a lot of coins that are just saying, okay, here's Dogecoin, as a dog, as a mascot, there's not really a value behind it. So Storj is one of the best examples I can think of that has intrinsic value by itself, even if nobody had trusted the network behind it. So.
So we put this calculator on here. Granted, nothing on this is a guarantee. So Dropbox, probably the most popular service in the country for cloud storage. A lot of people like to use it. They charge right now $9.99 a month for 1,000 gigabytes, so 1 terabyte. $10 a month, $120 a year if you pay by month for 1 terabyte. I know for a fact, 6 terabytes of hard drives laying in a drawer at my house collecting dust. How many people here have hard drive space laying around? I think everyone here has spare hard drive space. If you could provide that to the network, it would help grow the network and increase its security. The more people participating, the more we can distribute files. You don't have one single point of failure. You don't have a central authority like Amazon Web Service, who also holds all the CIA's files. I don't know if you want your files stored right next to where the CIA has direct access. That's just me. I looked at one file, the new service that was coming out, it was O-Drive. I looked in their terms of agreement. They reserved the right to modify, view, change, withhold, distribute, do anything with any data you put on the network. They hold the keys. With Storj, you hold the keys. The power is in your hands. What you do with your data is your business. We can't see it, we can't touch it. The person storing it doesn't know what it is because they've only got a small piece of it, and it's encrypted and hashed. It's your data. Use it when you need it, when you want it. you want to give it to someone, that's on your business. I mean, we're not here to police, but I think the legitimate uses of this type of network, just the same with the legitimate uses of all Bitcoin transactions, will greatly outweigh any downside risk of people misusing. So I'm not going to keep you guys very long because I know you want lunch, but does anybody have any questions or hardware questions Andrew can jump in and answer to?
Just two questions, one's real quick.
Oh. Yeah.
No, you're right. Whoever would like to go.
I was just saying, two quick ones real quick. One is, do you know the redundancy ratio for the...
We're going to have a base redundancy of 3. We're going to provide an option for you to increase that. If you wanted 100 times redundancy, you'll pay for it to the people that you're storing the file to.
Okay.
You don't pay for the whole storage of the file either up front. You make small microtransactions as you're verifying the integrity.
Okay. And then the other question is on the coin itself. So we were talking about this today just a second ago. So does a counterparty asset, can you buy and sell that on another exchange other than counterparty?
Yeah, so we're on Poloniex right now, and we're also on...
we're on Melodic, Master Exchange.
And we're getting added as many as we can. So it's really any exchange at this point. Well, Polo,
okay.
Obviously, is the biggest.
Thank you.
I'm assuming you guys, I'm really ignorant on y'all's history. I'm assuming you guys are somewhat of a startup, right? Can you give a little background on your story, where you're based out of, kind of what your short-term history is and how big y'all are right now?
Sure. Back in March, the founder of our project, Sean Wilkinson, is a student at Morehouse College in Atlanta. He came up with the idea, was at the Texas Bitcoin Hackathon, and won the Texas Bitcoin Hackathon with his project. So it started there. So we have Sean. Jim Lowry here is our lead advisor. Tom Wyszewski does all of our graphics and helps out with our videos. He's amazing at that. What was that?
He's in from Macedonia.
Yeah, he's in Macedonia. Josh, there on the right, is leading the development of MetaDesk.
New York.
Then we got Will, large majority of the team here. We're all kind of spread out all over the world working. For funding for the project, we did hold a crowd sale in July, from July 18th to August 18th. And that's how we are deciding at first access to testing the network. The first people that will be given access are those that contributed to the crowd sale and hold more than 10,000 storage coins. So they contributed the most, they received the most coins. Those are the people we're going to give the first shot. Then it will be all participants in the crowd sale, and then anyone who has gotten interested in the project and is currently holding 10,000 storage coins. That will be about early 2015. Once we move beyond that, we're going to open it up to the rest of the world. Hopefully we'll have a little bit more polished product at that time. So yeah, if you're interested in purchasing any, you can get it on the counter wallet, decentralized exchange, which can be a little funky still. Melodic, Poloniex, any of those. During the crowd sale, we did raise about 940 Bitcoin. So that's how pretty much everyone on the team, me and Derek and Andrew, were all volunteers. The few paid people we have and providing for travel and stuff like that comes out of the Bitcoin funds.
Any more questions?
You just mentioned a crowd sale. How did that work? Did you guys give up equity in doing that, a part of it, all of it?
No.
You just sold the coins?
People who participated in the crowd sale purchased access to the software, is what they did. If they gave more, they got some coins along with it. That's how it went incentivized. There was no equity. Should not be considered a security in our belief throughout, because we're not providing a guaranteed profit. We're not. People will main trade the coin, but there shouldn't be any.
Is that how you guys got off the ground then? Was it how you funded?
Yes. Okay. Yes.
Anybody else?
So two questions. The first is, does anyone else do something like this, where you get paid to store something on your hard drive?
There is some other similar projects trying to do something similar. MainSafe has been around for since before Bitcoin. They've been trying to do the decentralized Internet of Things type of work. So they do have a similar idea of how to go about this, but they're taking a different method than the others. And they've also been going at it for 7-8 years. So I know Sean has said when he was doing his due diligence on the project that he got in contact with the MainSafe people, and there's possible we could easily integrate the projects together.
My second question is about the economics.
It's about the economics of it. How? So let's say I have a hard drive and I want to rip it out.
Mm-hmm.
When do I get paid? Do I get paid directly or at the end of the month or how?
Constantly. What we'll do is, if you want to put like the drive share verify page up, is that okay? Yeah. So if he hovers on one of these nodes here, clicks on it. So he clicked on mine, it's just showing in the US here. I have passed 2,133 heartbeats with a 100-byte file, is my preliminary pass. What we're looking at doing is each of those heartbeats are going to be a small microtransaction.
How often is that?
It's about once a minute right now.
So there is a network kind of self-sustaining network check, but with something that Sean and Vitalik and Ethereum that we're talking about in Chicago is that we're going to have different types of checks. I'm not a developer, so I can't really get the whole kind of underside of this. But what basically it's going to do is that since we don't want to kind of jam up the network with a ton of data that we're just checking things in the entire file, because you can have huge data, 10 gigabyte movie files in there, and checking that every second, that's going to get extremely cluttered. So what they're talking about is imagine that each file is kind of a circle. We're going to check part of that circle. If that's verified, and the entire file has been edited, or we can go around and check it once at a time. And then the user, one kind of, I can call it an aspect, a tool we would kind of implement is if you really want to check the integrity of it, you can pay and get a full hash check for the entire file, and that will give you 100% this has not been changed at all. So I think the default right now is not the entire file. Obviously for the bigger ones, that's going to be extremely hard to do. But it's going to be more of a part of the file check. That's right now. But we can always change.
All right, let's thank Ryan again.
Oh, one more back there.
One more? Okay, one more question.
Okay.
we don't have a lot of time, but...
I can just...
It's a good idea.
What about the bandwidth quality?
As far as the download getting back to you?
Yes, yeah, so, I mean, right now it looks like, you know, So let's say you're not in Chicago, right? And I want to rent a hard drive for some space.
Mm-hmm.
I definitely will care whether that's in the US or somewhere here in Japan.
That's right.
As a client of this, would I be able to select where I would be located? Or maybe more just about, you know, the bandwidth, the throughput and the latency. Access to that, and also as a provider of hardware of storage space, would I, you know, if I'm in a more convenient location, would I get paid more because I have more bandwidth?
We are looking at options on ways we could rank each node as being a higher reliability node or a higher bandwidth node that could result in higher reward. For the time being, we're probably just the beginning of this testing phase here. I mean, right now we have 7 running, and we're just testing to make sure that we can verify an integrity of a file right now. We'll move on to the first test A and then test B. We'll keep expanding those. We've got to collect data to see what it's really going to make a difference. Because right now, let's say you use BitTorrent for something. You don't really care what their upload bandwidth is because it's being provided by each little piece of that file is coming from a bunch of people. In the same aspect, if you have a large file, it's going to be coming from a lot of directions all at once. So your choke point is probably going to be your download speed, depending on where you live. Where I live currently, the fastest I'm able to get is 50 megabits per second. So it's pretty quick, but I only have 5 megabit upload. So that's going to be a choke point for some people. And it really depends on where you live and where your bandwidth is.
All right.
Super fast. Do you generate tokens by hosting files?
You do not generate tokens. Every token is already generated. They are already in existence. There are 500 million storage coins. And that's all there will ever be. The distribution of those coins, we created them. It's a counterparty asset. So it's not like finding a block and mining generates a token.
Right.
With counterparty, you create a fixed amount. You can make a whole bunch of different options with it. So you got 500 million coins. The distribution for that was 70% was rate reserved for crowd sales or early rewards for the network. Basically, that's kind of a way for the company to raise some money if it's needed. 15% of the coins are a developer's fund that's paying some of the developers for their work. They're collecting that. Something different that has been done with storage coin that if you look on Bitcoin Talk, you'll see all the announcement threads and it'll say like 10% pre-mine for the developers, the rest of you fight over the rest. Something we did was 15% of the coins are allocated for community use, for you people to decide what to do with. You can get on our forums. If you think that's something that should be spent, it should be spent, put a proposal up there, community can vote on it. If it passes, we'll go forward with it. And that's how I was elected, was on our forums. Someone could vote to impeach me if they wanted, I suppose, and kick me out.
So,
Derek's eyeball on me here.
Sorry, are those coins divisible, highly divisible?
Same as Bitcoin,
yes. Yes, same as Bitcoin, 8 decimal places.
Okay, well,
thank you.
There's a lot of interest.
You can come to our table. Come to our table.
Well, after lunch here, we'll go hang out in the other room there. If you've got questions, come bombard us with everything you've got. So.
Thank you very much. All right. We'll have Elizabeth Clochet on.